Okay, everybody. Now this is, we have now 3 weeks to finish this semester. We have 2 more weeks after this week. And the topics we have left are the most important topics of the course. Namely, we will talk about, we will finish determinants. I want to tell you a few more things about determinants today. Afterwards, I will talk about eigenvectors, eigenvalues, and we will continue afterwards. Okay? As we discussed, next Monday we will have our quiz. This coming Monday we will have our second quiz at 5, we said, right? At 5, where in this classroom and in 2 classrooms. And the following Monday we will have our third quiz. And last week, on the 26th of December, we will have our usual class. Then we will have a review session the same day, Thursday, from 6 to 9 p.m. So we are going to solve questions similar to the ones that you will see in your final, okay? I didn't want to make it the following week. Maybe some of you will go home. Go back to your family, etc. So we will have a problem session as well so that you have a chance to see enough problems to be able to prepare for your exam. Okay? So let me just continue determinant a little more while, so do some examples, etc. So how did we define the determinants? We said that given a matrix A, n by n, right? Square matrices. So the following properties define a number, it's a number, right? Associated with A. So one, determinant of identity is equal to one. This is a definition, like vector space conditions, right? So this is one. Two, if you exchange 2 rows, the sign of the determinant will switch. Three, determinant is linear for individual rows. What this means is the following. If I have a determinant of, let's say, A plus A prime, B plus B prime, C, D. What was this equal to? This was A, B, C, D plus A prime, B prime, C, D. Okay? And the other property is that this again, this is, let's call this A and this B. TA, TB, CD is equal to T times determinant of A, B, C, D. So the following is not correct. Determinant of A plus B is not necessarily equal to, okay? This is not true, okay? This doesn't mean that, right? This is linearity with respect to any row of the matrix, okay? It's not linearity as a whole. This is not also true. Okay, just so that no, this is not true. Okay, that's it. Okay, then what did we talk about? We said if you have, so the fourth property was if A has two equal rows, then what? Then the determinant is zero. How do we prove that? Now these are like the conditions for definition of determinant. These are derived now. From four onward, these are results of these first three properties of determinant. How do we prove this? Yes. So let's say you have, excellent. So you have a determinant with Ri and Rj, and these are the same. So this is, let's say, jth row, this is ith row. Okay, you have two equal. So determinant of this, let's say, is A. If you exchange these two rows, what are you going to have? You will have, if after you exchange, what do you have? You still have the same thing, right? But determinant has to be equal to zero. Yeah, you have to switch sign, right? But it is the same thing, since that means determinant of A is equal to minus determinant of A, that means determinant is zero. So easy, right? Okay, this fifth property was if a row is zero, I mean entire row, if an entire row, okay, entire row is zero, then determinant of A is zero. Why is that? Just here, right? If a row is just, that means entire row is zero, means just take this t equal to zero for that row. That just multiplies the determinant, okay? How about if I multiply the entire matrix with t? What would this formula be? If I didn't, It is, if it is 2 by 2, it will be t squared. If it is n by n, it will be t to the power n. So for every row, a t will come to the front, okay? So, six. So I'm just quickly going over this. I explained this in details last week. So, but I just want to, okay, subtracting a multiple of a row from another row does what? Yes, excellent. Does not change the determinant. The determinant. This is so beautiful, isn't it? It makes our life so easy. Again, Gaussian elimination becomes part of the game, and it just makes life very easy. So how do we prove this? Let's say I have an A. Okay, so I have R1. Ri, of course, in the exam, I might ask you to prove some of these, right? Another thing is that in the exams, the worst performance is in the proofs. No matter how trivial is the proof, almost nobody touches it, except a few people, okay? Mathematics is proving things. Mathematics is not you accepting because Davut is saying it or Ahmed is saying it. You say, whoever is saying it, prove it. That's mathematics, right? So that's mathematics. The rest is just something else. Okay, so I have Rj and Rn. Okay, these are rows, right? Row 1, row 2, row I, row j, row n. So I obtain a matrix, let's say A tilde. I take R1, Ri remains the same. I go and I just multiply this with L and subtract it from this row. Multiply this row with L and subtract from here. So what do I have? Rj minus L times Ri. Rn, right? So let's look at now determinant of A tilde. What is this now? What do I do? How do I resolve this? Linearity, right? So determinant is linear with respect to a row. So therefore, you have here a row that is adding two things, right? Every element. So what do you have here? So this is R1, R2, Ri, Rj minus Lri, Rn. So determinant, this determinant is equal to, so plus determinant of what do I have here? And what is this equal to? Can I take this L out? Why? Again, it is linearity property, second linearity property of B, right? So this can come out. So you have here what? Two equal rows. So therefore, this determinant is equal to zero. This is just determinant of A. Therefore, taking a multiple of a row and subtract it from another row does not change the determinant, the value of the determinant. So it remains unchanged. It's so nice. Okay. If so another property, so this is what? 6, 7. If A is upper triangular, is an upper triangular matrix. Of course, n by n, right? So when you talk about determinants, the matrix is square, okay? I don't need to write it anymore. Then the determinant is equal to the multiplication of the, we didn't talk about eigenvalues yet, of the diagonal element, of the diagonal. Elements. Okay, we need to prove this. So you have A, so it is A11, 0, A22, 0, 0, A33, and you have just anything here, right? A, N, N. So we want to talk about the determinant of this matrix. This property we just proved is telling us that if you take a multiple of a row and subtract it from another row, the determinant does not change. So what can I do? I can just take A and N and just take appropriate multiple. These are all zeros, right? I can just take some multiple of it, subtract it from here. Then I will make all these zero, like in Gauss-Jordan. Okay? When would this fail? When can I not do this? Huh? If this AN is zero, okay, if AN is zero, then what is the determinant? Why? Because I have a zero row, isn't it? Okay, so this is not zero, I made this zero. I came to the previous one, I made this also zero. I came and I said, in somewhere again, I faced a diagonal element that is zero. So what happens then? What do I say? Determinant is zero, why? Resolve, because I already made all these zero, right? Using the previous columns, previous pivots starting from ANN, I made entire column zero, entire column. I came there, and if this is zero, this is zero here, all the left of it is already zero, right? Because this is an upper triangular matrix. That would mean the right of it is also zero. Itself is zero, therefore you have a zero row. That means the determinant is zero. Why? Because of the, we proved it, right? Okay, so therefore, this is equal to, since this row operations, because of property six, does not change the determinant, I can say that this is equal to A11, 0, 0, 0, A22, 0, 0, A33, etc. ANN. It's a diagonal matrix. So what is the, how do I find the determinant of this? No. Using the linearity property, this one. Take T out, right? So take T out. So this is equal to A11 times 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, A22. So then I would go and I would say lots of steps. Then I take A22 out, then it becomes A11, A22. So this way, I would go all the way and A and N, right? Times 1, 1, 1, 1. What is this? Identity. What is the determinant of identity? 1, by definition. So therefore, determinant is if you have an upper triangular matrix, the determinant is just multiplication of the diagonal elements. Okay. How about if it's a lower triangular matrix? Any difference? So therefore, upper or lower, right? I don't need to even explain this to this class. We did so much of Gaussian elimination that is just automatic. So therefore, a triangular matrix, upper or lower, doesn't matter. Then you have the determinant is equal to just multiplication of the diagonal elements. Good. Okay, property 8, we talked about eight. If A is singular, A is singular if and only if determinant of A is equal to zero. Okay? Of course, in this course so far, how did we define singularity? Okay, sometimes and most of the times we define singularity for square matrices as if the determinant of A is equal to zero, then we call it a singular matrix, right? But in this course so far, what did we call a singular matrix? We said, what? Doesn't have an inverse, it's a result of it. It has linearly dependent columns, right? Meaning, A is singular means there exist x different from zero such that ax is equal to zero. Of course, this is zero vector, right? What does this mean? Ax means what? This is linear combination of the columns of A. That's what it means, right? So therefore, if you can find an x, a non-zero x such that ax is equal to zero, that means A is singular, okay? So we call this is the definition of singularity we defined so far. So since we are now talking about square matrices, for a singular matrix, if you apply Gaussian elimination, what are you going to have? You will have a zero row, right? If you apply Gaussian elimination to a singular matrix, let's say null space has dimension 1, okay? If the null space has dimension 1, Then left null space, what is the dimension of the left null space? For a square matrix, 1, right? Because rank of a matrix, left rank and right rank, they are the same thing. Rank is just one thing. What do we call as rank in this course? Rank is the number of non-zero pivots of the matrix. So therefore, so if rank is R, then n minus R is the dimension of the null space, left null space or right null space. It is the dimension. So therefore, you will have some, let's say, U11, right? U22, etc. Maybe you will have a zero column, okay? But in general, you will have a zero row, at least one zero row, right? It doesn't have to be at the end. So, but you can exchange it, then you have to account for minus of it, like we said here, right? So by applying, you take A and apply bunch of row operations to A. So rank of A is equal to rank of E times A. So that this becomes U. U is the LU factorization is U, right? So if this U has a zero row, then what would that mean? Determinant is zero, right? If U has a zero row, that means determinant of U is equal to zero. On the other hand, what can you tell us? That means some Y transpose U is also zero, right? Or some Z transpose A is zero as well. Because there is a null space in it. There is a non-zero null space of this. Therefore, determinant is equal to zero is, last week I proved this in more details, but it's just to remind you, you can look at the video as well. So if the determinant is zero, it's a singular matrix, okay? It has a non-empty null space, and if it has a null space, the determinant is zero. So these are the equivalent things, okay? If you have any questions, of course, please stop me. As long as you don't stop me, I see there is no problem. I continue. You will have some questions on this in the exam, for sure. Okay? I can guarantee you that. Okay, how about determinant of A times B? Okay? How did we prove this? This is equal to determinant of A times determinant of B. How did we prove this? Can somebody tell me? LU, yes. So what do we do there? Not LU, we say that row operations do not change the determinant, right? It's right here and we proved it. So therefore, I said the following. Let's take A and perform row operations on this. E1, E2, E what? E L, okay? 1 million row operations. Is this determinant equal to determinant of A? These are row operations. This multiplication means take a multiple of one row, subtract from the other one, or add it to the other one, right? Does it change the determinant? Doing it 1 million times, does it change the determinant? It doesn't, right? So therefore, I can look at this just one E. So E times A, as long as this E corresponds to row operations, okay? This is equal to determinant of A. So this E, I select this such that this E times A is equal to a diagonal matrix, okay? D11, D22. DNN, Any problem with that? So therefore, I say, then I take this. So determinant of AB, this is equal to determinant of E times AB. But you might say, but this E was row operations for A. It wasn't for row operations for this, right? It doesn't matter. It's just row operations. Maybe it will not make AB a diagonal matrix. It doesn't have to, right? That's not what we are after. But it is not going to change the value of the determinant. But what I will do is that I will just first consider this here. So therefore, this tells me this is equal to d11, d22, dnn, 0, 0. And this is b is just r1, r2, rn. These are row vectors, right? So that is equal to, this means multiplication of first row with d11, second row with d22, third row with d33, etc. rn. So I now use linearity, right? What do? I just bring this out. So we have a T here. We don't have T. What do we have? D11. We take this out. So this comes out as D11. This comes out as D22, DNN times determinant of R1, R2, RN. What is this? This is just, so determinant of D11, D22, DNN, as we just talked about, this is equal to, okay? And that's equal to determinant of the original matrix A. So this tells you, this teaches you a good way of computation of the determinants, right? So this is how you compute determinants using Gaussian elimination. That's it. So this is determinant of A times determinant of B. So we proved it. Very simple and easy, right? Now, this one thing I didn't tell you last week was determinant of A transpose is equal to determinant of A. So how do we prove this? LU, right? So determinant of A, let's say A is equal to L and U. What is this? L is a lower triangular matrix, and U is an upper triangular matrix, right? So what is determinant of A? Determinant of L times determinant of U. And this, since these are lower triangular, what are the diagonals of this? In this exam, I saw this. So many people made that mistake. You just take L and then you just exchange the rows and columns of L and make it into something. Then what is the meaning of L, right? So L is just diagonal is 1, and below it, upper, so above the diagonal is 0, and below the diagonal you have multipliers, right? That's what L is. That's what LU factorization stands for. And U is, diagonal is the pivots, and above diagonal is just any numbers, and below diagonal is 0, okay? So this tells you that this is equal to 1. This is equal to just diagonal of this d11, d22, dnn. How about A transpose? So A transpose is U transpose, L transpose, right? So U and U transpose, do they have the same diagonal? Therefore, can we say that determinant of U transpose is equal to determinant of U? Why? Because U is an upper triangular matrix. It has a diagonal. U transpose is a lower triangular matrix. It has the same diagonal. But I can just eliminate below and above the diagonal using Gaussian elimination. Therefore, the diagonal will remain the same. Their multiplication will remain the same. Therefore, this is true. Did everybody understand this? U is not a general matrix. U is in this form. U is like D11, D22, DNN. Is 0 here and just anything here, right? This is U. L is 1, 1, 1, 0 here, and anything here, right? So this has diagonal all 1. Therefore, this determinant is 1. And this is, so therefore, determinant U transpose equal determinant U. Therefore, determinant of A transpose is determinant of U transpose, determinant of L transpose. This is equal to 1. This is equal to determinant of U, which is equal to determinant of A. That's it. So these are all of the properties of the determinant that we very nicely are able to observe. Okay. Now, let's further develop and do some exercise, really, using these. Of course, 30, 40 years ago, when we were taking this class, the most of the linear algebra was about determinants, okay? Determinants and cofactors, but not anymore. Now, linear algebra is now much more efficient course and much more easy. Okay. Now, let's say I have this, A, B, C, D. Last week, I showed you using Gaussian elimination how to get this determinant. But now I will use linearity property. Okay? So how can I use this is equal to what? I can say this is linear with respect to first row, right? I can say A, 0, C, D, right? Plus 0, B, C, D. So I just separated the first row using the linearity property. Okay? Now I can continue doing this. I can continue on this. What can I say? This is equal to A, 0, 0, D, right? Plus A, C, 0, 0. So I now use the linearity with respect to the second row. Okay? So I first took this one, then this one. Okay? How about this one? So this is this term further is broken down in this term. So you have just two elements in this. How about this one now? What can I say about this? 0b, this is 0d, right? Plus 0b, c0. So this is linearity property for this one. So you can just look at this a, b, c, d in this form. What can I say here? This determinant, this is 0. Why? Because it has a zero column. Okay, we didn't talk about zero columns. But transpose of it, determinant of the transpose, is equal to itself. Therefore, whatever we are saying about the rows is true for columns as well. Why? Meaning if you have a zero column, the determinant is equal to zero. If you have two columns that are equal, the determinant is zero. If you take a linear multiple of a column and subtract it from another column, the determinant doesn't change. All those things that we described, we gave you as properties for rows, it is true for columns as well. So it applies exactly. And of course, that follows from this property, isn't it? Determinant of A transpose is equal to determinant of A. So that is 0. This is 0, right? So what is this? This is, again, this is a diagonal. So it is A and D. So how do we do this? As a matter of fact, we take out A using the multiplication property. Let's be mathematically correct, right? And this, you have this. So we want to make identity. We want to arrive at identity. What do? I interchange these two rows. So what has happened? This is C, 0, 0, B. And minus comes here. Why? Because I interchange two rows. These two are 0. Okay? I can also take this C out. This becomes 1. So I can continue one more time. And now take this D out, right? A times D, 1, 0, 0, 1. And here, C times B, 1, 0, 0, 1. What is the determinant of identity? 1. So therefore, you have A times D minus C times B is the determinant. So using these properties, you can just take a 1 million by 1 million matrix. And in theory, of course, that's not how I suggest you should do it. You could obtain the determinant of any matrix using these properties over and over and over. Okay? Yes? Okay. This is rule number 2. If you exchange two rows, the sign of the determinant will switch. So I just, these two rows, I exchange them. I put this up here. Okay? C, 0 became the first row, and 0, B became the second row. Okay? Good. So if it is 3 by 3, it becomes, of course, very cumbersome. In 2 by 2, you don't see it, but it explodes. I will just highlight it for 3 by 3, and I will not spend any more time on this. Okay? And maybe in problem session, I will solve some problems, because otherwise, we'll not be able to cover the material we need to cover. Okay? So if you have a 3 by 3 matrix, A11, A12, A13, A21, A22, A23, A31, A33. Okay? Now we use the linearity here. Let's say with respect to first row. So what is going to happen here? So A11, 0, 0, A21, A22, A23, A31. Plus, what am I going to have here? 0, A12, 0, A21, A22, plus 0, 0, A13. Okay. Then what am I going to do? I will continue. Let's say I can do it with respect to the first row, first column as well, right? So what am I going to have? I will have one element that has a 0 row, right? When I continue like this, the Cramer's rule that you are most familiar from your previous experience will start showing up, okay? So if I were to let me continue a little bit more, okay? So I have here 0, 0, 0, A21, A22, A23, A31, A33. So this is, okay? So then I have here A11, 0, 0, okay, A22, A31. 0. Okay. A 3, 2. Okay, 0, 0, A 3, 1, 0, 0, A 2, 2, A 2, 3, A 3, 2, A 3, 3. Okay, so for each one, again, I have 3 matrices, right? This is 0. Okay, so as you see, this is equal to 0. That is equal to 0. And only one of them is non-zero. I will further continue, and I will make the same thing here, right? Use the linearity with respect to this. Then I will use linearity with respect to this. So just I will have to do how many operations? And factorial operations. For example, 2 by 2, what is 2 factorial? It is 2. It was very easy. We did it. For 3, I will have to do 3 factorial, 6. Then for 10, it just becomes unbelievably. It's even, this is even more than n factorial. The remaining non-zero elements will be n factorial. Of course, as you see, it is much more than n factorial elements. You have to. Do you understand how it progresses? Because if I want to continue this, I would spend one more hour and nobody would understand anything. Wouldn't understand anything. So you can look at the book to see the details. But we are not going to too much concentrate on this approach in this course, okay? But you should know it. So let me give you, okay? This is using the linearity property, how you compute determinant of a higher order matrix, okay? In general, let me just make this clean board so that you don't confuse it with that. If you have a matrix, n by n matrix, A11, A12, A1n, A21, A22, A2n, the cofactor Cij is defined as the matrix, the determinant of the matrix obtained from A by erasing ith row and jth column multiplied by minus 1 to the I plus j. Okay? For example, C11 is just, you just take C11 is associated with this one. You take out this row and this column. And remaining is matrix is, what is the dimension of it? n minus 1 by n minus 1, right? So you calculate that determinant. Okay? So you would hear C11. You would calculate that determinant and multiply it with e to the 1 plus 1, a minus 1 to the 1 plus 1, which is 1. So therefore, C11. Then you would calculate C12, C1n, etc. Okay, these are the cofactors. This is the definition of cofactors. Okay, C12, C1n, etc. Okay. So the determinant of A is equal to, with respect to, let me write it for the first row, okay? Then I will write it in general, is equal to A11 times C11 plus A12 times C12 a1n times c1n. Meaning, determinant of an n by n matrix can be written in terms of n minus 1 by n minus 1 matrices. Okay? So you can just expand this determinant with respect to a row or a column. Okay? It can be any row or any column, right? So this doesn't have to be the first row or first column. It can be any row or column. Let me do an example on this to make it clear. Let's say you have a matrix 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 2, 1, 1, minus 1, 2. Okay, I want to calculate this determinant of this matrix. So I can calculate it using any row or column. Which one would I use? Because all these elements, these are coefficient of the matrix, right? So which one would I pick? I would pick the row or a column that has the most number of zeros, right? That's the logical thing. So I would say, I will just expand it with respect to this second row. So it will be 0 times C21. Okay, I don't need to calculate because it's multiplied with 0. Okay, what would be C21 anyway? It would be this. You just erase this row and this column, right? With this element, but whichever row is associated with this with the element, you cover it. So it would be -1, -1, -1, 2, right? But I don't need to compute it. Then 0 times C22, what would that be? It would be 1, -1, 1, 2, right? But I don't need to compute because then 2 times C23. So this goes away. So you have 2 times, what is C23? What is it? Who is going to tell me? So you just cover this. It is 1, 1, 1, 1, right? So what is this equal? So of course, you would also multiply this with. This is I is 2 and J, so it is 1 plus 2 plus 3. So this is minus 1. But here you have a determinant with two equal rows. What is it equal to? 0. So therefore, this determinant is 0. Okay? Also, we call this the cofactor matrix C, A inverse, this is the Cramer's formula, is equal to determinant of A times C transpose. Okay? This is an alternate definition or way of computing A inverse in terms of cofactors. Of course, we never use these to compute A inverse. How do you compute A inverse? We use Gauss Jordan, right? Gauss elimination is a beautiful way. Yes, Ibrahim. Yeah. So you study it from the book because I don't want to spend any more time on this one. I am just giving you a brush over it because if I go deep into it, we are going to spend too much time. And I'm afraid you will not understand too much out of it anyway. But this gives you an introduction. It's very well explained in your book. I'm sure everybody has the books. So you study in the book, and if you really wonder about it, you can ask me afterwards. Okay? Now I want to start the beautiful subject of eigenvalues and eigenvectors. Okay? I can safely tell you that eigenvalues and eigenvectors and related topics is really the most important tool or the subject that comes out of linear algebra as far as engineers are concerned. Okay, this is the topic for important for all engineers. for us. Okay. So last week I made a quick introduction to this, and I want to repeat that. I want to see where, how does eigenvalue come up? Why do we need that? Instead of giving you the definition of this is the eigenvalue, I just want it to naturally to come out. Okay? When you have differential equations, let's say we give you a differential equation. What is a differential equation? That is, we are telling you that I want you to find a function that satisfies this. You take derivative of it. Derivative of that function should be equal to multiplication of the function by this a. A is like, let's say, let me just give it a number, 2. Okay? So twice the function is equal to the derivative of it. Okay? And this function that I want to find has initial value, let's say, y0 is equal to minus 3. Okay? So what is this function? Okay? This is, of course, will be taught to you in differential equation course. But since this is extremely simple, we just solve it here. So we say that, of course, this is different from 2x equal to 5, right? This is called, what? This is an equation. This is not a differential equation. Here you are trying to find a fixed value x. You are trying to find a number here. What is x so that this is satisfied, right? But here you are looking for a function that this is satisfied for every t, right? This is called, that's why this is called differential equation. So we say that, let me make a guess. Can I look for a solution in this form? Meaning, can I find a c and a lambda such that such a function satisfies this differential equation and this initial condition? Okay? What do you do for that? You just take the derivative and substitute in the equation. So what is the derivative of this? That you know, of course. What is the derivative of this? C lambda e to the lambda t. Substituted here, C lambda e to the lambda t is equal to 2 C e to the lambda t. This e to the lambda t is, of course, always positive, right? E to the lambda t for 0, it is 1. For this, for positive lambda, it has such a, this is 1. Okay, for negative lambdas, it is like this. So it is, but it is never 0. It's always positive. Therefore, we can cancel this. So what did we find out? We found out that C lambda should be equal to 2C. Or take common, so lambda minus 2 C should be equal to 0. So if you can determine lambda and C such that this equation is satisfied, then this function would satisfy this differential equation. So we can have C equal to 0, right? If C equal to 0, then function is 0. Does 0 function satisfy this? Yes. But can you satisfy the initial condition with that? No. So therefore, trivial, that's called the trivial solution. So C equal to 0 is the trivial solution, which is useless. Why? You cannot satisfy the initial condition. So C is different from 0, okay? Then what do you have to have? Lambda is equal to 2. So therefore, the solution we have is yt is equal to C e to the 2t. So how do I determine C? I want to satisfy the initial condition, right? So y0 should be equal to minus 3. So what is y0 here? C e to the 2 times 0. So this is 1. So therefore, C. So C is equal to minus 3. Therefore, the solution here is yt is equal to minus 3 e to the 2t. So this is the solution of the linear differential equation that satisfies the initial condition. Okay? As a matter of fact, this is the only solution for that. Okay. Now, when we have a system of linear differential equations, what do? We always generalize, right? Whatever we did for a simple case, that's the scientific approach, we try to generalize it to the more general case. Let's say we have dy dt is equal to, or dy1 dt is equal to minus y1 plus y2, dy2 dt is equal to y1 minus 2y2, okay? And we have y1 0 is equal to minus 1, y2 0 is equal to 5. So we would like to find two functions, y1 and y2, such that it satisfies both of these differential equations at the same time. They are coupled, right? And satisfies the initial condition. Okay, now since this is linear algebra course, we know how to look at this kind of problems, right? How do we look at it? We say, let's call this y is equal to, yt is equal to y1t, y2t, right? In that case, how do we write this equation? So dy dt, y now here is a vector, is equal to, I will have a matrix A, and I will have here y1, y2, which is y again. So what is this now? Minus 1 and 1, right? 1 and minus 2. So that's equal to ay. So you have dy dt is equal to ay. Okay, so this is A. So when you have a system of first order differential equations, you can write them in the matrix form, okay? And this also you can represent as y0 is equal to some initial vector. These are vectors, right? These are all vectors. After a while, we stop writing all these vector arrows and t's, etc., because it is clear from the context. So we want to find a solution for this system of first-order linear differential equations. What shall I do? Huh? Utku, what shall I do here? No, you are too fast. Why did we do this example? So what should we do here? We say, we guess a solution, right? We say yt, let's guess a solution as e to the lambda t times some vector c. Okay? I want to see if I can find such a function where I would like to find what should be lambda and c. This is the question. So can I find a lambda and a c that will satisfy that such a function would satisfy this differential, this system of linear differential equation, it satisfies the initial conditions? Okay? That's the question. So this is again vector. Is it clear so far? I'm not going to continue until you understand this. Who understood what I am doing here? Please raise your hand. Okay? So one third of the class understood. Please ask me the others. Where did you get lost? Okay? What's the problem? So which point you missed? Did you understand? Who understood this one? Okay? What is the problem? What did you understand here? Huh?
I
You understood. Who did not understand? I'm not going to shame you. Just please tell me where you got lost so that I can resolve it. Okay? Who did not understand this? Okay. Where did you get lost? What's your name? İknur. Where did you get lost here? So did you understand what a differential equation means? Yes? You understood. So we are looking for a function that will solve this equation. Meaning, here you are not looking for a number like a scalar equation. You are looking for a function that you take derivative of it. Of course, everybody knows what is a derivative, right? You take a first order derivative of it, and it should be equal to twice that function. This is an example of differential equation, right? I said an approach for this would be, let me guess a form for a solution. Can I look for a solution having this form? A constant number, C, which I don't know. I can call it a parameter, okay? And an exponential, e to the lambda t. Can I pick C and lambda such that this form of function would satisfy this differential equation and would satisfy this initial condition? So I'm making a guess, okay? Or I'm trying a way to forward. So far it's clear now? So I take derivative of this. Of course, here C is constant, lambda is constant. E is just, we know, 2.71818, right? That's Euler's number. So I take derivative with respect to t. So what is the derivative with respect to t in exponential function? Just this lambda comes here. So dy dt is c lambda e to the lambda t. It's clear so far? So I substitute this here. So dy dt c lambda e to the lambda t. And 2 times c e to the lambda t. So this is yt, this is dy dt. Is it clear now? Okay. So e to the lambda t is common in both sides. I can just cancel it because it is a non-zero number. Whatever it is the same thing in both sides. So when you throw it away, what you are left is c lambda should be equal to 2c. You bring them together, lambda minus t times c is equal to 0. Okay, so since I am now trying to find what did I do here? I converted the finding a function problem into, can I determine two parameters in a smart way so that this function will be solution for this, right? So I reduced to a problem of finding two parameters, determining the value of two parameters. Is it clear now, İknur? Good. So here, when I have lambda minus 2 times c equal to 0, when can this be satisfied? It can be satisfied in two ways. You can have c is equal to 0. If c is equal to 0, that means yt is equal to what? Zero function, right? Zero function satisfies the differential equation. But does it satisfy this one? No. So therefore, c equal to 0 is not a viable option. So what is the other alternative? This parenthesis should be equal to 0. So this tells you that you can pick lambda equal to 2. If lambda is equal to 2, this is satisfied. Okay, and this becomes yt is equal to c, right? This. You take lambda equal to 2 because that's what you found. Yt is equal to c e to the 2t, right? Okay, so we have the solution. Now we need to satisfy the initial condition. So you substitute t equal to 0 here in both sides. So y0 is equal to c, e to the 0 is what? 1. So y0 is equal to c. So what is y0? It's minus 3. So c must be minus 3. So I determine lambda and c. And I satisfied the differential equation, and I satisfied in this condition. I have the solution, right? So this is how you solve a first-order scalar differential equation. This is how we solve it. Yes?
Why did we pick natural number?
Excuse me?
Why did we pick natural number, E?
Oh, it doesn't have to be natural number. It can be just anything. It can be 1.3 or minus 722.83. It can be any number, okay? It's just any number, okay? Any other question? At this level, there is no silly question. So please do not be ashamed or hesitant. Yes? Oh, this is my experience. I tried 1 million other ones, and this is one of them I am trying. This, okay? Like Edison, before he discovered the light bulb, how many trials did he make? More than 1,000, maybe 10,000. He tried everything else. Of course, it's not that. I mean, I didn't. Just assume this is how we do it, okay? Now, so this is how we solve a single first-order differential equation. Now, I want to go and see if I have two first-order differential equations, and they are coupled. So y1 depends on y2, y2 depends on y1. You see, they are intermingled, right? So where do we face these kind of equations? In mechanical systems, in electrical circuits, anywhere in nature, everywhere, it's full of these. You have, of course, millions of these running around. In an integrated circuit, you would have 1 million of these together, right? You would have many, many, many equations like this, okay? So it's everywhere. I said, let me first put this in a standard form. So why we have two unknowns functions here that we want to solve, so y1 and y2, okay? So we call it a vector, y vector, right? It has two components. It's a variable vector, y1t and y2t. And I said, let me write it now in terms of this yt. So you have, so this is, so let me just do this, dy1 dt, dy2 dt, okay? So dy1 dt is what? Minus y1 plus y2. Ignore, is okay now? Abdul Fattah, it's clear? Is it clear now? It's not. Okay, is this clear? So I have a differential equation. How did I obtain it? As I said, maybe from electrical circuit, okay? From somewhere it came up. dy1 dt is this. So I want to write this in a matrix form. So I have one equation, dy1 dt is equal to minus y1 plus y2. Okay, dy1 dt, this is a vector. The first component is, there's a matrix here, y1, y2. So this matrix into this vector, what do you get? Abdul Fattah, what do you get? Minus y1 plus y2. Is it the same? dy2 dt, this is y1 minus 2y2, right? Is this the same as this one? Who agrees that this is the same as this one? Okay, who doesn't agree? Please ask me so that you will lose the rest of it, okay? This is very important that we make sure you understand this. So here I have two equations. You are familiar with this, right? Before we had this with x's, they were not functions, they were just parameters that we want to define, we want to determine. Now we have functions, right? So this differential equation, one differential equation, another differential equation, they are coupled together. So dy, so I write this in the matrix form. There is nothing more here, okay? So I call this A, and I call this y. So this is dy dt is equal to ayt, okay? And this is initial condition. So the problem in general, you can have, this is the nice thing about abstract mathematics, is that you just develop something for a general form. This could be 1 million differential equations, right? It doesn't matter. It's just dy dt is equal to ay, okay? So a could be, a would be determined by what? How many differential equations do you have, right? This would give you that. So I am doing the same thing here. Ignore, help me please. How do I solve this now? Okay? I want to determine here lambda, and I want to determine the parameter lambda and vector c, such that when I substitute this function in this differential equation, of course this is a system of differential, this is a matrix form, it will satisfy it, right? So I take derivative of this. So what is the derivative of this? What? Lambda e to the lambda t times c. C is, of course, c does not depend on t, right? It is just a parameter we want to determine. We don't know it, but it is a fixed vector. Okay. So I substitute this here. So what do I have? Left-hand side, lambda e to the lambda t times c is equal to a times e to the lambda t c. As a matter of fact, this is just a parameter. Let me just take it here. Okay. So this e to the lambda t again, since it is common in both sides of the equation, I can just cancel it, right? So I have lambda c is equal to ac. In other words, this c has to satisfy this, and lambda c and lambda, they together, they have to satisfy such an equation. Did we see this before? We did not, right? This is, we have two unknowns here. They are multiplying each other, and they are, it looks complicated, isn't it? So such lambda is called an eigenvalue of A and C is an eigenvalue associated with lambda. That's it. So this is how you face eigenvalue and eigenfunction. It so naturally comes out. If you are dealing with a differential equation, you want to obtain the solution, it tells you, yes, you can find the solution, but you need to find what is a lambda and C that satisfies this. Okay? Okay. Any questions so far? I will start building upon this now. Okay. Let me give you another one other than differential equation. Let me give you a difference equation. Okay, I have another way of why you need this. Okay? So with digital computers, of course, we do things in discrete time. Two people left. Okay, take another. Okay. So if you, let's say, minus 2.5 xn and x0 is equal to, let's say, 1.8, just to avoid why it's a natural number, okay? So it is not a natural number. So I want to find, this is called a difference equation. Of course, this course is not about differential equations or difference equations. Don't worry about it. I'm not going to ask you questions about how to solve this differential equation or anything. I will ask you about eigenvalues and eigenfunctions. But so that you understand why is he talking about eigenvector, so that it makes sense to you, these are the kind of equations you face in your engineering systems. In a digital computer, this is the kind of equation you would solve in telecommunications, information theory, control theory, system theory. This is image processing, and in artificial intelligence, in anything, you would face this kind of equations. Okay? So these are digital. This is like digitized version of the differential equation. That's how you can look at it as well. So when you have one equation like this, I play the same trick. Okay, I say, Ibrahim, what should I say here? Can I find a C and a lambda such that such a function would be a solution for this and it would satisfy this initial condition? Can I find C and lambda? So can I find C and lambda such that the difference equation and the initial condition is satisfied? What should I do? Just substitute, right? So what is xn plus 1? Ibrahim, what is xn plus 1?
C times.
C times lambda? Lambda to the n plus 1, yes. Okay, let me just substitute here. So C times lambda to the n plus 1 must be equal to minus 2.5 times C lambda to the n. So what do I have from here? If I cancel this, then I have C lambda should be equal to minus 2.5 times C. Take them to the same side. So lambda plus 2.5 times C should be equal to 0. Okay, Ilknur? Does it look familiar? It is familiar, right? So when is this satisfied? Either C has to be equal to 0 or lambda has to be equal to minus 2.5. C equal to 0 will give a trivial solution. It will satisfy this, but it's not, you cannot satisfy the initial condition. So therefore, C is not equal to 0. Then you have lambda equal to this, and then Cn will be C times minus 2.5 to the n. Of course, this n is natural number. Otherwise, you will have problem, right? If it's like 1/2, then you wouldn't have square root of a negative number. Okay. And how do I determine C? This is not Cn. This is Xn. Okay. So X0 is C times something over 0. What is that? 1. That should be equal to 1.8. Therefore, we determine C from here. And xn is equal to 1.8 times minus 2.5 to the n. So this is the solution of the difference equation, right? So very similar, isn't it? Solving differential equation and difference equation looks very familiar. And when you take the courses like singles and systems and automatic control, we'll teach you these things in very much details. So if you want to generalize this to now system of difference equations, okay? Okay, so I'm not, let's say I have x1 n plus 1 is equal to minus x1 n minus 2.5 x2 n. x2 n plus 1 is equal to minus or 3 x1 n plus x2 n. Okay, and I also have x1 0 is minus 1, x2 0 is equal to minus 2.7, let's say. Okay, so I have an initial state of my variables. I want to see at every step how it develops, right? So how can I solve this? I will put this again. I will call, I'm now making this quicker. X1 and x2, right? I will say n. Okay? So I will have x is equal to x n plus 1 is equal to a x n. What is a? In this case, minus 1, minus 2.5, 3, and 1. So what kind of a solution am I going to guess now? Can somebody tell me from the back rows? So what should I guess my solution? Can you help me? Yes? You are here, right? So please pay attention. Okay. So what is xn then? What will be my guess? Utku, what? How am I going to guess this?
I couldn't see the board.
You couldn't see the board. Okay, do you see it now?
Xn c times.
So it is going to be, so I want to find the lambda to the n. I don't know what lambda is, but a parameter. Then c, right? I want to see if I can find such a solution, right? Okay. So what is xn plus 1? It's equal to lambda to the n plus 1 c. You substitute here. So you have lambda to the n plus 1 c is equal to a lambda to the n c. I can just take lambda to the n here and a here, right? So lambda to the n is common in both sides, so you cancel this. Then you have lambda c is equal to a c. In other words, just bring them to the same side, you have a, don't bring them to the same, a c is equal to lambda c. So we again face the same condition, right? Yes, you can find such a solution, but lambda and z are related to a like this. So a times c has to be equal to lambda times c. Okay? I will give a break here for 10 minutes so that you can recover. I hope you don't smoke, because smoking is one of the worst things you can do. But just have some fresh air and come back after 10 minutes. So we'll now we know why do we face eigenvalue and eigenvector, right? How it naturally comes out of a physical problem. So now we know it. Now we will deal with eigenvalues and eigenvectors from now on. Okay? Break. Okay. So I had several questions during the break, so it's good. And now the question Abdul Fatah is asking is the following. Okay. Why on earth do you have this? dy dt equal to ayt. Why is this? Okay? So this is not going to be always true. This is not how we ask it. This comes from the nature. Like this is your capacitor or your inductor or this is your mass moving, okay? This is your rocket in the sky. So this is mathematical model of your physical process. So it's not something you define. It is given to you from the nature, from the problem, engineering or science problem you are dealing with, you face differential equations, okay? If you want to throw a stone and the wind is blowing like this and you model it, you will see that you will have a bunch of differential equations to model that physical phenomenon. So this is something is given to you. Your problem as an engineer is to find a solution, to understand what does this mean in terms of, so what's going to happen to my variables? Are they going to blow up or are they going to die down? Or where are they going to be after 1 hour? Okay, so you get the answer of those questions by solving the differential equation. Of course, it's not going to be a first-order differential equation like that. It's going to be a bunch of many other equations, nonlinear, linear, and you would have to find ways to deal with them. So it's not, so this is not something you define. It is physics of the problem that gives you that. You are subject to that. Your job is to find a solution for it. Okay? Any other question? Okay. Now we can fully start now the eigenvalue and eigenvector subject. Okay? At this point, we know why. Is everybody convinced that eigenvalue and eigenvector is important? Is everybody convinced? Who is convinced about that? One, two, three. Okay, too few. I expected more. So the problems you will face in your engineering life and as a scientist or as an engineer will be always multivariable. So this is what it means. If you have just a single variable, so dy dt is equal to some ayt, this we call this a single variable problem. But in reality, the problems you will face, they will be very complex. You will have tens, maybe sometimes hundreds, sometimes thousands of variables interacting together. Like you have a circuit with 5,000 capacitors and 50,000 resistors and 5,000 inductors, whatever. And what kind of a behavior does it have? You need to analyze this. So it will require that you solve thousands of these equations. They are coupled together. Okay. Now, eigenvalues, eigenfunctions. Okay. Given a matrix A, of course, a square matrix, a square matrix. Lambda and x satisfying ax are called eigenvalue and associated okay. So let me give you an example. For example, if I give you 1, 0, 0, 2, I want to find an x such that ax is equal to lambda x. So how can I solve this? So I have 1, 0, 0, 2. This is not how we are going to do it, but just for the time being, let's try to see if we can find a solution. This is what we want to do, right? So the first equation gives us x1 is equal to lambda x2, right? So this is x1 is equal to lambda x1. I'm sorry. And second equation gives you 2x2 is equal to lambda x2, lambda x2. So I need to find, so lambda is here what? What does this tell you? X1 is equal to lambda, so lambda is equal to what here? Lambda is equal to 1, right? Or x1 is equal to 0. This is the first. For the first equation to be satisfied, lambda has to be equal to, lambda should be 1 if x1 is different from 0. Or x1 is equal to 0, then for any lambda it is satisfied. Second equation tells you what? Lambda is equal to 2 or x2 is equal to 0. Okay? So this has, looks like this has two possible lambdas for this to be satisfied. Okay? So I would take, I can take lambda equal to 1 in the first equation. Then I would take x2 equal to 0. Okay? So then what would I have? I would have 1, 0, 0, 2 times 1. So x2 is equal to 0, and I have here, let's say, 1. Okay? So is this satisfied? 1 times this is 1, 0, 1. So this is satisfied, right? So what do I have here? Lambda is equal to 1. What do I call this? An eigenvalue, right? And what is an eigenvector corresponding to that one? 1, 0. So it satisfies Ax is equal to lambda x, okay? This is not how we solve it, by the way. I'm going to give you, just we are just building upon it, okay? What would be another solution? I could take lambda is equal to 2, then what would I take? To satisfy the first equation, I would take x1 equal to 0, right? So then I would have 1, 0, 0, 2, then x1 equal to 0, so this is just x2 can be anything. So I would have here lambda is equal to 2 times 0, 1. So is this satisfied? So 0, 2. So this is also satisfied. So lambda is equal to 2 is an eigenvalue, and x is equal to 0, 1 is an eigenvector. So for this matrix, in a cumbersome way, okay, we were able to determine two eigenvalues and their corresponding eigenvectors. Okay? They both satisfy this. In general, when you have this, so you have an x, you multiply ax, what do you have? You get a linear combination of columns of a, right? It's such a special linear combination of columns of a that comes out the same vector, okay? So you multiply this a with a very special vector that will give out the same direction. So if something comes in that direction, it goes out in the same direction. These are eigenvalues and eigenvectors of it. So how do I find this? Let me just bring them together. Ax minus lambda x. If I want to write this in a matrix form, then I have okay. What does this tell me? What is this x in terms of null spaces and column spaces, etc.? Well, where does x belong to? It's in null space of so x is in null space of a minus lambda I. So of course you can have x equal to 0, right? Is x equal to 0 a meaningful solution? No. So that's trivial solution. That's not what we are after. So x 0 as eigenvector is not something that's called a trivial solution. It's not useful. So we are looking for non-zero eigenvectors. Okay? So in order for this to have a non-zero eigenvector, what do you need to have? The null space should have at least dimension 1, right? Meaning this a minus lambda I should be singular. What is the latest singularity test we developed? Determinant. Okay? For a minus lambda I x to have a non-zero solution, we must have determinant of A minus lambda I equal to zero. Okay? So if you find the lambda that makes the determinant equal to zero, then what do you do? What is the next step? You look for the vectors that span the null space of this A minus lambda I, right? For that lambda. So you find, let's say lambda I, such that A minus lambda I is singular. Okay? Such lambda I is called an eigenvector. Eigenvalue of A, matrix A. Okay? And the vectors that span the null space of the singular matrix are called the eigenvectors. It so nicely fits into the language we developed, right? All the concepts we developed, the subspaces and null space and the column space and everything. Now we start picking up the fruits of it. So for this to have a solution, this has to be singular. Therefore, singularity test, now we have the determinant has to be equal to zero. Find those lambdas that make this determinant equal to zero. Then this is singular, therefore it has a null space, right? It has a meaningful null space, at least one-dimensional null space, right? So rank. So this is n by n. Rank can be at most n minus 1 here. So you would have at least one eigenvector associated with that lambda I. The rank would drop 1 or 2, or it could drop n. So I will give you examples of it now. OK. Before I go further, let me just visit this example now and do it in a more scientific manner now. OK? So what this is telling me is that, let me now revisit this example. 1, 0, 0, 2. So find the eigenvalues. So the first thing is eigenvalues. So this way we are decoupling it. You first find the lambdas that make A minus lambda I singular, okay? Then afterwards, in the second step, you find the eigenvectors, okay? So how do we do that? Determinant of A minus lambda I is equal to determinant of 1, 0, 0, 2 times lambda 1, 0, 0, 1. I am doing every little detail here so that you don't get lost, OK? So what is this equal to? Determinant of 1 minus lambda, 0, 0, right? And 2 minus lambda. So what is the determinant of a diagonal matrix? What is this equal to? 1 minus lambda, 2 minus lambda. So you set this equal to 0. So when is this equal to 0? Either lambda is equal to 1 or lambda is equal to 2. So call this lambda 1, call this lambda 2, or vice versa. So these are the eigenvalues Now, let me keep this here so that we can go back. Oh, it's, we have them there. Okay. So here I did not use our subspaces or anything. I just did it, just brute force method, right? I did not use any knowledge of singularity and determinant or anything. Now I am using it. So this is telling me, what this is telling me is that for lambda 1 equal to 1, I have now a minus lambda 1 I will be equal to what? So this is 1, 0, so 1 minus lambda, 0, 0, 2 minus lambda, you put here lambda equal to 1. So what is that equal to? 0, 0, 0, 1. So what is, so I want to determine the null space of this, right? The eigenvectors will be null space of this. So a minus lambda I, lambda 1 I, times x equal to 0. So that means 0, 0, 0, 1 times x1, x2 should be equal to 0, 0. The first equation just gives you nothing. Second equation gives you x2 is equal to 0. So therefore, x1 is free. So what is the null space? X1, x2 is spanned by 1, 0 times x1, right? So now space is spanned. So this is the eigenvector. How many eigenvectors do you have? It's one dimensional, right? So you just need to find the basis for it. Any one of them will do. Any multiple of an eigenvector is again another eigenvector. Look here. If x satisfies this, 10x also satisfies it, isn't it? You just multiply both sides by 10. You divide it by any number. So you just need to find the basis that spans it, okay? Okay, so this is the first eigenvalue, and we obtained this singular matrix and found the vector that spans the null space. It is 1, 0 spans the one-dimensional null space, right? Now let's take a minus lambda 2i. What is that equal to? So that's equal to 1 minus lambda, 0, 0, 2 minus lambda. Okay? So this time take lambda equal to 2. So what do you have? So 1 minus 2, 0, 0, 0, which is minus 1, 0, 0, 0. Okay? So the null space of this, I will just do it here. Minus 1, 0, 0, x1, x2, equal to 0, 0. So what does this give me? X1 is equal to 0, x2, no condition. Therefore, x1, x2 is equal to 0, 1, times x2. So I found them, right? So I found now two eigenvalues and two eigenvectors for that matrix in a systematic manner, right? The first way I did it, I didn't use anything. And you cannot in general, it would be very difficult and cumbersome to find solution in that way. Any questions so far? Any questions? This is the simplest question you can have, other than having just a scalar. It's not a matrix. Any question on this? Everybody understood this? Who understood it? Please. Okay. What is the problem? What did you not understand? You are in the first row, so please tell me. Nothing to be ashamed of. We just started this. Okay, where did you get lost? Did you understand this? This is the basis of it, okay? So this eigenvalue, I will just repeat this again. So eigenvalue and eigenvector means that for a matrix A, you have a lambda and an x associated with that lambda, okay? Such that ax is equal to lambda x. So a is multiplied by an x, it gives the same x back, just multiply the number. And that number is the eigenvalue, okay? How can you find this? This is a non-linear problem, isn't it? You have two unknowns. What are the unknowns? Two, of course, this x is a vector. So let's say x is an unknown and lambda is an unknown. So you have two unknowns multiplied together. It's a non-linear problem, right? So how can we solve this? You just bring this to the left hand side, ax minus lambda x. You bring them into, x is common in both. So a minus lambda I times x equal to 0. Is this clear so far, everybody? Is everybody clear for this? OK. So in our terminology, in the midterm and the quiz, and we have been talking about this for the last 3 months, isn't it? What does this mean? This can be satisfied if x is equal to 0, right? But x equal to 0, of course, satisfies this. But that's not what we are after. That's not what we call an eigenvector, OK? So it's not an eigenvector. It's a trivial solution of this equation. So can we find a non-zero x that satisfies this? Yes, we can. But in that case, what would that mean? You have a matrix here, right? A matrix is multiplied by a vector, non-zero vector, and gives you zero vector. When can that happen? If A minus lambda I is a singular matrix, right? So A minus lambda I has to be singular. Luckily, A minus lambda I does not depend on x. It only depends on lambda, right? So it's beautiful. So we just talked about last class that A minus lambda I singular means determinant of A minus lambda I is equal to 0. So we need to find the values of lambda for which A minus lambda I's determinant is equal to 0. After we find those lambdas, then we will go back and we substitute that lambda here and solve for x's. That's the algorithm, OK? So you first find the lambdas that will make A minus lambda I singular by using some methodologies that we will talk about. After you determine the lambdas, the eigenvalues, then for every eigenvalue, you will form the matrix A minus lambda I, OK? And this will be singular. Why? Because that's how we picked the lambda I, to make this determinant equal to 0. So this is a singular matrix. Therefore, it has a null space, OK? It has a null space and non-empty null space. So we will find the vectors in the null space of A minus lambda I. Yes? Excuse me? A minus lambda I? I am trying to solve this. I didn't understand. Türkçe sor bak. Evet. Nasıl yazacağım? Yani şimdi yani bu şöyle. Okay. The question is, why do you have lambda I here? Okay? The reason why I have lambda I there is so I have lambda x. Okay? I want to separate this x and lambda. So how do I write this? I can write this as an identity matrix, OK? Lambda, lambda, lambda, 0, 0, and x, right? This is the same as this. Do you agree? This is the reason. OK, let me write this more explicit. X1, x2, xn. Meaning lambda x1, lambda x2, lambda xn. Do you agree? Multiplying a matrix or a vector with a parameter means you multiply every element of it. So this can be written also as like this. Can I write this as lambda I? Okay. And this is x. This is x. So lambda x means lambda I times x. That's what it means. So there, when you have a x minus lambda x, this is the same as a x minus lambda I x, because I x is the same as x. So therefore, take common with x, that's a minus lambda I x. Okay, now it's clear. Okay, everybody clear? Good. We are trying to solve the equation. That's the whole thing. We are trying to find lambda and x that satisfy this equation, right? We are trying to find lambda and x that satisfies it. So we bring them together, and this is how we put them together. Is this wrong?
It's not like that. You cannot subtract from a lambda.
Yes. You cannot subtract a scalar from matrix. This is what it means. Okay, that's why this is what it means. So that's what it means. Okay. So for this to be satisfied, anyway, I don't want to repeat myself. Let me solve another question here. It's very good that you ask questions so that I can adjust my speed and I can make more explanations. Otherwise, if you don't interact with me, it's like watching on TV. So it's very important. That's why we are together in this room. Okay, let me take another example. Okay, so find the eigenvalues and eigenvectors. So what am I going to do? Who wants to help me? How am I going to solve this? No Gauss Jordan. What do I do? Determinant of, I will just form this. A minus lambda I equal to 0. I will first compute this determinant with respect to lambda. Okay, what is it? So it is A minus lambda I is equal to, A is 4, 1, 1, 4 minus lambda I 1, 0, 0, 1. So what do I get? Ibrahim, what do I get now? 4 minus lambda 1, 1, 4 minus, my brain is passing my hand. Okay, this is, so determinant of A minus lambda I is equal to what? So determinant of 4 minus lambda 1, 1, 4 minus lambda is equal to, what is the determinant of this? This times that minus this times that, right? So determinant of A, B, C, D is equal to A, D minus C, B. Okay, that's equal to 4 minus lambda, 4 minus lambda minus 1, which is 4 minus lambda square minus 1. You want to set this equal to 0, right? So what are the solutions? 4 minus lambda square is equal to 1. That means 4 minus lambda is equal to 1, or 4 minus lambda is equal to minus 1. So this gives me lambda is equal to 3, and this gives me lambda is equal to 5. So I found the eigenvalues. Okay, what shall I do now? Utku, what am I going to do now?
Find
Utku got 90 something, okay? He fixed, he really fixed his gray. He must be happy. Huh? Girmedin mi? Okay.
Find the null space.
Girmemiş. Karıştırdım. Hmm? Find the vectors that span the null space for each eigenvalue. Okay? So, I have 4 minus lambda 1, 1, 4 minus lambda. For lambda 1 equal to 3. What is this equal to? 1, right? 4 minus, let me just substitute here. 1, 1, 4 minus 3. So that's equal to 1, 1, 1, 1. Aha. Is this singular? Does it look singular to you? Okay. So what is, okay, what, okay, 1, 1, 1, 1. What would be x1 and x2 that makes this equal to 0? Huh? Not 0, 0. So taking linear combination of the columns. So, come on, man. 1 minus 1. Okay. 1 minus 1 is an eigenvalue, eigenvector, okay? Eigenvector with this. So I should now have A times 1 minus 1 should be equal to 3 times 1 minus 1, if I didn't make a mistake, right? Let's see if this is true. A was 4, 1, 1, 4. 1 minus 1, this is equal to what? 4 minus 1 is 3. This is 1 minus 4, this is minus 3. What is this equal to? 3 times 1 minus 1, bingo, right? This is x, this is x, this is lambda, this is a. So ax is equal to lambda x. Lambda 1, x1, x1, okay? So we found the eigenvector, and first we obtained the eigenvalue, then we have the corresponding eigenvector. Now here, let me take care of the other one, okay? 4 minus lambda, 1, 1, 4 minus lambda. Here, lambda 2 is equal to 5. So what do I have? 4 minus 5, 1, 1, 4 minus 5, that is equal to minus 1, 1, 1, minus 1. Okay? So minus 1, 1, 1, minus 1 times x1, x2 equal to 0, 0, 0. So what is it? 1, 1. So x1, the eigenvector is just 1, 1. So if I multiply A times 1, 1, I should obtain 5 times 1, 1, right? Let's see if that is true. So A was 4, 1, 1, 4 times 1, 1. What is this? 4, 5. 1, 5, right? So that's equal to 5, 1, 1. Bingo again, right? X, lambda, x, and a. So ax equal to lambda x. Here it is. So nice, isn't it? All these determinants and singularity and all these concepts we learn, they now make our life easy. But you will see as we develop next week and the week after that we have so many beautiful properties that we will face. It will make things very clear. It will help us a lot. So these eigenvalues are probably the most important parameter for the matrices. It tells you many things about the underlying system. For example, stability has to do with eigenvalues. In automatic control theory, we try to design feedback control systems so that the A matrix of the closed-loop system has eigenvalues in a certain manner. Okay? Okay. Let's take projection matrix. The projection matrix, the good old projection matrix. Let me do it here. If I have a diagonal matrix, okay, eigenvalues of diagonal matrices okay, if I have A is equal to A11, 0, 0, 0, A22, ANN, and everything else 0, okay? What are the eigenvalues and eigenfunctions? Find the eigenvalues and the eigenfunctions. Eigen, of course, not functions, it's too early for you, for eigenfunctions, eigenvectors. yes, later on you will find out about eigenfunctions as well, okay? So, again, we know the drill now, right? Determinant of A minus lambda I has to be equal to zero for eigenvalues, for eigenvalues, lambda. Okay. So what is that in this case? A minus lambda I is equal to A11, 0, 0, A22, ANN, minus lambda 0, 0, 0, lambda 0, so what is this equal to, Ibrahim? A11 minus lambda 0, 0, 0, A22 minus lambda, ANN minus lambda. So what is determinant of A minus lambda I? So what is the determinant of this? What? What zero? You have a diagonal matrix. So we set this equal to zero. To find what? To find the eigenvalues. So what are the eigenvalues? For what lambdas this is equal to zero? Yes, lambda 1 is equal to A11, lambda 2 is equal to A22, lambda n is equal to ANN. That's it. So simple, isn't it? So for a diagonal matrix, the elements, the components in the diagonal, they are the eigenvalues. So nice. So diagonal matrix is the best you can have. What is the next best you can have? Upper triangular matrices. Again, yes, let me find, of course, the eigenvectors for this, right? Okay. So let me find, so lambda 1, let me find, so I have lambda 1 is equal to A11, okay? I'm not going to do it for AII, just to make it simpler. So what is X1, the eigenvector? So A minus lambda 1 I is equal to what? What is this? Zero. Thank you. This is? Okay. A and N minus A11, right? So I need to have this X1, X2, Xn should be equal to 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. So what do I have? What do I have? Second equation tells me what? Come on. Abdul Fattah, what does this equation, what does this tell me? These are all zeros. What is xn? Zero. What is xn minus one? Zero. What is x2? Zero. What is x1? Free variable, right? So therefore, what is the eigenvector? 1, 0, 0, 0. Okay, what is the eigenvector for lambda 2? Etc. Right? So the standard basis vectors are eigenvectors of this diagonal matrix. Okay? So nice. Okay, let's go to the next nice example, triangular matrix. So you have and garbage. Okay, sum, not zero, anything. Okay? So let's find the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors. Of course, I should always say eigenvalues and the corresponding eigenvectors, right? For every eigenvalue, you have corresponding eigenvector or vectors. It could be more than one. I will give you an example of that. So determinant of, okay, this is we will keep doing the same thing. A minus lambda I equal to zero. Right? This is the key. We need to solve lambdas that make this determinant equal to zero. Okay? So that you, what do you have? So A11 minus lambda, just 0, A22 minus lambda, ANN minus lambda, determinant of this. Okay, should be equal to 0. What is this determinant equal to? Again, multiplication of the diagonal elements, right? We just did it. Determinant of triangular matrix is equal to the multiplication of the diagonal elements, isn't it? So this is equal to A11 minus lambda, A22 minus lambda, ANN minus lambda, equal to zero. So again, the elements in the diagonal, they are the eigenvalues of that matrix. That's good. So for triangular matrices also, you have the same thing. Of course, what are the eigenvectors? Eigenvectors question is not that easy, right? For example, let me give you a 2x2 example, okay? 1, 2, 0, 2, let's say, okay? In general, eigenvalues are like this. Okay? So eigenvectors can be many different things. It's not like that. Okay? It's just you have to apply Gaussian elimination and find the null space of this corresponding to that eigenvalue. Okay? So what are the eigenvalues here? They are lambda 1 is equal to 1, lambda 2 is equal to minus 2. Right? So A minus lambda I is equal to 1 minus lambda 2, 0, 2 minus lambda. So you put lambda equal to 1. Lambda equal to 1, then you have 0, 2, 0, 1. So you have x1, x2 should be equal to 0, 0. What does this tell you? X2 is equal to 0, right? Then x1 is free. So x1, x2 is equal to 0, 1 is eigenvalue. Okay? Then Take the same. And take lambda is equal to 2. Then you have here minus 1, 2, 0, 0. Okay? X1, X2, equal to 0, 0. So this tells you minus 1, minus X1 plus 2X2 is equal to 0. This tells you X1 is equal to 2X2. So what is the spanning thing? 2 and 1. This is the eigenvector corresponding to that one. Now, I will give you two very small examples, and we will stop. We will consider the following matrices. A is equal to 2, 0, 0, 2. And A is equal to 2, 1, 0, 2. Okay? What are the eigenvalues of this? Lambda 1 is equal to 2. Lambda 2 is equal to 2, right? Okay. What are the eigenvalues of this? Okay, now let's find the eigenvectors of it, right? So what do you have for the first one? You have A minus lambda I is equal to 2 minus lambda 0, 0, 2 minus lambda. For lambda is equal to 2, you have a double eigenvalue at lambda equal to 2, right? It has multiplicity 2. So it is twice. So this gives you 0, 0, 0, 0. Okay? What is the dimension of the null space of this matrix? What is it? 2. Okay, well, that's equal to the entire R2, right? So any vector is an eigenvector of this. Just take any vector, right? Just take any vector x. So twice identity times x will give you what? 2x. Right? This is A and this is lambda, right? Now let's look at the other one. So A minus lambda I, what is that? 2 minus lambda, 1, 0, 2 minus lambda. So at lambda equal to 2, what do you have? 0, 1, 0, 0. So can you say the same thing here? No, they have the same eigenvalues, isn't it? Both of them have 2 as a multiple eigenvalue. But let's look at the eigenvectors. X1, X2 equal to 0, 0. So what do you have here? The first one tells you that X2 has to be equal to 0. And there is no condition X1. So what is the eigenvalue? X1 and 0. So it is 1, 0 is a basis. That. So what is the dimension of this? How many pivot columns do you have here? One, right? This is non-zero pivot. So here the null space has dimension 1. But we have two eigenvectors at 2, right? We have multiplicity 2. But we have only one eigenvector in this null space, because null space has just dimension 1. So therefore, it's not always true that if you have two eigenvectors, you will have two eigenvalues, you will have two independent eigenvectors. Okay? Of course, if the eigenvalues are distinct, you are always guaranteed to have independent eigenvectors. We'll prove it next class. But if you have multiplicity, then you have this kind of cases where you will not have equal number of independent eigenvectors. Let me give you another small example and we quit. Zero, one, minus one, zero. What are the eigenvalues of this? Okay, determinant of A minus lambda I has to be equal to zero. So what is it? So zero minus lambda, right? One minus one, zero minus lambda, which is equal to minus lambda one, minus lambda. So determinant of is equal to what? Lambda square? Is it minus one? Plus one. So we make this equal to zero. Okay? Complex. So there is no real number that will satisfy this, right? Lambda square has to be equal to minus one. So what are the lambdas that satisfy this? Minus and plus j. Okay, in mathematics we call them I, but in electrical engineering we call I for current. Therefore we use j in electrical engineering. Okay? So therefore j. So j square is equal to minus one. So as you see, we started now eigenvalues and eigenvectors. And we did several examples. We found out that you always have n, if for n by n matrix, we didn't prove this, but we will. You have n eigenvalues, but you don't always have n independent eigenvectors. As we did for 2 by 2 example, we have 2 eigenvectors for lambda equal to 2, but we only had 1 eigenvector. So the null space had only dimension 1. Okay? And we found out that very simple matrix like this, with pure linear, real components, has complex eigenvalues. Therefore, we will have to talk about complex numbers a little bit, okay? Complex numbers is again a magical subject in mathematics. I will give you a very basic understanding of it next class. Before we continue, I really recommend you to listen to complex numbers next class, okay? It's mandatory anyway. Thank you for coming. See you next week. See you on Monday for the quiz.